The VAR Show. The one place for your weekly football update.
Hola, a very warm welcome to the VAR show, the show which talks about all the various major football leagues in detail. Today we are going to continue the theme of interviews, and we have a very influential figure in terms of Indian footballing culture, Asian footballing culture, in fact, and hopefully he continues being a very influential figure in the future also. We have the former manager of Bengaluru FC, also the former manager of Penang FC, and former director of football of ATK, Mr. Ashley Westwood. For those who do not know, Bengaluru FC is an Indian professional club in Bengaluru, Karnataka, India. Penang FC is a professional club in Malaysia. And ATK is a professional club in India based out of Kolkata and participates in the Indian Super League. Okay. So, Mr. Ashley Westwood had his most successful time at Bengaluru FC, where he won two I-League titles and one Federation Cup title. So, Mr. Ashley Westwood is also a product of the famous Manchester United Academy. And in 2007, Mr. Westwood followed Michael Appleton's journey to championship side Blackpool to work as first team coach. He was also in the technical staff with Appleton at Blackburn, but set about on his own in 2013. So in 2013, Westwood joined newly founded Bengaluru FC as head coach and guided them to the maiden I-League in the very first season. He then guided the Bengaluru-based club to Federation Cup into 2014-2015 season, before guiding them back to the I-League title in 2015-2016 season. Despite the success on the field, Westwood and Bengaluru FC parted ways by mutual consent on 31st of May 2016. There are talks about it being regarding the contract and the wages, so that is not confirmed. But then after that, he then had an ill-fated spell at Penang FC in Malaysia before being appointed as director of football at ISL side ATK. He also had brief spell in between Teddy Sheringham's and Robbie Keane's tenure as the head coach of ATK. He's also a double pro license holder. He holds both UEFA Pro and AFC Pro license that very few of them hold. So without wasting much time, I would like to thank Mr. Westwood for coming on the show, especially in times like this. So thank you and welcome to the show. First, I would like to ask, you know, the general question, like, how are you and what are you doing during this pandemic period?
Hi, thanks for having me. Always nice to interact with people, and obviously strange times at the minute, so gives you something to do, speaking to people all over the world. Personally, I have kind of a daily routine, really. I get up in the mornings, I take my dog down to the local field, I do some exercise for about an hour or so, bring the dog back, have lunch, take the dog out again for another walk, and then my partner's working. She comes home maybe about 7 p.m. I cook some dinner, we watch some TV, and then do the same again tomorrow.
Okay, so we'll jump straight into football now, because that's what we are talking about. So you have been in quite a different places. Like, you spend most of your time playing career in England, but you have been in management in Malaysia and mostly in India. So how do you compare the football culture maybe in India to what you were accustomed to when you were playing back in England?
Yeah, I think obviously when I came to India, it was 2013. I'd finished playing at 35. I think I came to India around about 38, something like that, 37. And I had a couple of years in England coaching. I was assistant manager at Portsmouth, Blackpool Football Club and Blackburn Rovers. But then I came to India where it was a little bit of an unknown. It was growing, like I said. I think it's got even more popular now. But I think the culture difference is, in England, it's part of of your everyday life football, really, especially as a young boy. There's so many junior teams around. There's so many, you know, academies around. So many professional academies around. You know, access to football is quite easy. You know, the schools are all well equipped with football fields, and it's on the forefront of every or most young boys' minds, really. You know, you have a local team, whether that be Manchester City, Man United, that you support. Football's everywhere on the TV, and you just play it, you know, every single day, basically, for hours on end as a young boy. So I think the culture is a little bit different in that sense. It's easier to play in England. It's harder, obviously, to play in India. Facilities aren't as good. And obviously, it's on TV everywhere. Like I say, every young boy is talking about it at school. So it's probably more intense in England. But as I said, India's growing. You know, the ISL and the I-League are obviously, you know, fully-fledged professional leagues now. And young boys can start, you know, supporting their local sides, and there's more and more academies coming up. So it's just different from it's a way of life in England as a young English boy. It's the first thing more or less you talk about with your friends.
So you were in the Manchester United Academy when you started. Then you went on, you played, you had a career, you played for Sheffield Wednesday and many other teams. And then you also want, like, you are in the maybe in the top echelon in coaching also. You are in Blackburn Rovers, which then was one of the good teams. So what brought you to India? Like, when you had such a good position there, and maybe you had left the job by the time when you had come to India. But coming from Blackburn to a uncharted territory like India, it might have been very out of the box decision for you.
Yeah, I think what had happened was I'd been an assistant at three clubs to a manager called Michael Appleton. We'd actually just got sacked at Blackburn Rovers. We felt a little bit unjustified in that decision, but things happen in football. And I knew, speaking to Michael, that he was going to take a while before he wanted to go back into football. He wanted to take stock of things. And as it happened, he had about 12 months out. So just the opportunity came up to go to India. It was a new club, a brand new club, which kind of appealed to me because you had a chance to put your stamp on it, build it from the bottom and do things how you would like it to be done without any infrastructure already in place. So everything that went on, you know, you could build from the bottom up. And I just came over with nothing to lose, eyes open. You know, at the end of the day, if it didn't work, I can always go back to England. So I just thought it was an opportunity to get involved in an exciting time, exciting country, exciting group within JSW. And put your own stamp on things and be the driver, really, rather than go to a club where things are already there. You know, you could have a say on what went on, and if it goes wrong, then it was, you know, down to yourself.
So you had tremendous success at Bengaluru FC, like amazing, like a new founded club. You won the I-League in the first season, then the Federation Cup, then again the I-League. You kind of laid the foundation or the founding stones to the giant club that it is today in regards of Indian football, like where Bengaluru is today. You are like maybe the founding father coach of the team. So how do you look back to your time at Bengaluru FC?
I look back at it very proudly, to be honest. Like you say, we won the league in our first season. I think what was the proudest moment was we were given a three-year plan. You know, we went in with a very small budget regards playing staff. We were told to build the club progressively, try and sign young players to stand in good stead for the future. You know, the actual targets of the given to me by the owners was finish out the bottom three year one, mid-table year two, and if you can get in the top three in year three, then that would be, you know, steady and remarkable success. As it happens, we win it in year one. We lost it by 1 point in year two when we should have won it, really. And we won it again in year three, so you look back proudly because, you know, you put systems in place, you put foundations in place, and a lot of them are still there today. You know, I left the club by my own accord, but I left the club in a strong position, and they kept being strong because I believe the foundations, the systems, the culture, you know, the drive, the winning mentality, the professionalism was all laid down. And that's, for me, the sign of a good coach. You know, a lot of coaches leave clubs when they've been sacked, and they leave the clubs because they've failed. You know, very rarely do coaches leave a bit of a legacy behind. and that's what I believe we did. And you know, it was no fluke for me that they then went on to win other things, because the core nucleus of players were there. You know, the mentality was there from out the Indians, and we let it stay, and it went on to be successful after we left.
So there were talks that there were some contractual talks which didn't pan out well between you and the Bengaluru board. So do you look back and think that maybe you have some unfinished business at Bangalore? Maybe you could have taken them to newer heights, maybe an AFC Cup. You'd never know. Do you look back with some maybe dissatisfiedness?
Yeah, I probably feel that we didn't finish the job off. You know, we left the club. I think it was the quarterfinals of the AFC Cup. They went on to get into the final, but lost in the final when really they, you know, if they'd have got the tactics right, I believe they would have won. They made some tactical changes towards the end of the game and it cost them. So I look at that and think, you know, if we'd stayed, maybe we could have stayed and won the AFC Cup. But you never know in football. You can't really have any regrets. It just leaves a bit of an unknown. And, you know, leaves a bit of you thinking that, you know, you can still make that side or grow it and win even more things. But, you know, it was a decision I took to leave. I believed it was the right time to leave, and you go on and your journey continues.
So you come as the new coach of a new club, virtually unknown in India, and you win the league first season. How did it feel? Because probably it was your first major trophy as a full-time manager, as in like being, how did it feel winning your first I-League with Bengaluru FC?
Yeah, it was just the icing on the cake, really. We'd done so much work off the field and in and around the club and building it, if you like. It was nice to win it, to be rewarded for all the hard work. But I think if we hadn't won it in the first year, we'd made such big strides and such improvements to Indian and Indian football, Indians and Indian football, that you know, it wouldn't have been the end of the earth if we hadn't won it, if we'd have gone on to win it in year two or three. But it was just nice. It was a great feeling, obviously. But just nice to be recognised with the actual trophy to reward you for all your season's hard work.
So were you going out in Bangalore with the team or something, to restaurants, maybe some team bonding parties or something?
Yeah, we had all kinds of things going on in the first year to lay the culture down. We always had a Christmas party. I remember the first one where I think we had fancy dress across the board. I think I wore a big Angry Birds outfit that I picked up from some fancy dress shop. Everybody, you know, made a real big effort to get into fancy dress. We took them out after 4 or 5 weeks hard work. I took them to the first Arbor Brewing Company pub down the road. And I think because I was so strict with the diet and the nutrition and standards in training, I told all the players they could eat and drink whatever they wanted. And it probably took about an hour really before the Indians actually realised that it wasn't a trick. I think they thought I was playing to see who was actually going to be a drinker and get rid of him, but that was never the case. But it was always nice to have the occasional night out with them, just to show them that there's another side, because, you know, when you're so strict and so intense in training, you know, it's important that they see another side to you and are able to let the hair down at the right time.
So I think you started the culture. I termed you as the person who laid the founding stone. They still go there. I had a talk with Carl's, the present manager, and he says they still go to Arbor for the Christmas parties. So
yeah,
you have a legacy still going on.
Yeah, no, it's nice there. It was a nice place.
Yeah. So you worked with quite a large pool of talented players in your career, maybe with ATK or Blackburn or Bengaluru. But one name stands out in terms of Asian football. That is Sunil Chhetri. How was it working with him?
It wasn't all plain sailing to start with. You know, he came as kind of a number 10, and I didn't play with a number 10, so I had to adapt his position a little bit and play him on the left of a three, which it took him a while to get used to. You know, he was subbed for the first game because his fitness levels weren't up to expectation. But working with him was fantastic. Never a moment's problem. Very dedicated, listens, take all the information on board. And it's nice to see him still being one of the best, if not the best Indian player, with his goal contribution, the way he plays the game. And it's nice to see him scoring goals that, you know, you've maybe sat down and coached him and he's listened and he's getting into those positions and you know, still to this day, scoring goals that you believe you've helped influence in a coach's perspective. But as a character, he was great to have around the players because he sets himself a high standard. He makes all the Indians abide to those standards. And, you know, he's an icon for people to look up to. They see him doing the right things and the other Indians follow suit and try and emulate him.
So you have coached in both the I-League as well as the Indian Super League, maybe only a brief time, maybe 6-7 games in the ISL. But according to you, which was more competitive and which one did you like?
It's hard really to compare because back in the day, the I-League was the one where there was a lot of competition in there. It was a longer season. You know, it was a 7-8 month season stretched out from maybe, you know, September right the way through till May. So that was always nice to have a long season. And then the ISL started 2 or 3 years where it was just, you know, 3 months long. You know, there's 6 or 7 foreigners per team, maybe 8 you could sign and play 5 or something like that. So it's changed over the years now. Obviously, looking at them now, they're still both strong leagues. You know, the finances are obviously more in the ISL, so I think you can attract probably the better foreigners, which lifts the standard of the game as well. And obviously, the marketing behind the ISL now is big. Obviously, with the TV revenues and stuff with Star Sports doing the production and obviously the reliance, you know, driving the product. So, you know, the biggest league at the minute, you would have to say, is probably the ISL, although the I-League is still strong. I still think there's a lot of work to be done within Indian football. You know, they haven't got the answers yet, but the more football, the better. And it was just hard to compare the two because, like I say, the I-League was the season campaign. But that's slowly shifted now where they both run parallel and they're both the same length.
So do you think like the Indian football maybe or should be stretched to a 8 or 9 month season instead of like a short, compact, brief version of a maybe a knockout? Like the ISL, although it's a league tournament, it gives you the feel of a knockout 3 month tournament.
Yeah, I mean, obviously the longer the better, really. The more football, the better in any country. You know, the more games you play, the better you become as a footballer. It's as simple as that. You know, you look at England, Premier League's 38 league games. The Championship, League One and Two are 46 league games. Plus you have your FA Cups and National Cup and stuff like that. So, you know, it's not unheard of for players to play 60 games a season. And then with the national team games on top of that, you know, players can be doing 70 games in a season, which is why they improve so quick. So the more football they get, the better. Obviously, I know in India now I've got a direct slot into the Asian Champions League, which is big for India and you know, needs commending. So there's been some great work done there. But when you look at the rules for the AFC Champions League, I think your domestic league has to have, 27 games, maybe something like that, for to enable you to fit in with the compliance of the Asian Champions League. So I think, you know, the Indian Super League will maybe grow, or the I-League will maybe grow and have more games because, you know, you need it. I think, like I say, when you retire in England, I retired in England and I think I played just short of 500 games. You know, and that's not one of the long. You look at people like Wayne Rooney, they've played over 1,000 games, you know, in their career. So that's why they become masters of the trade. You know, Indian players may retire in India having played maybe 200 games. You know, because there's not obviously as much football. So I think the more the better, to be honest.
So whom do you support in the English Premier League?
I'm actually a Man City fan, which was conflicting because I spent 9 years at Manchester United and obviously grew up of a class of 93, which was the year below David Beckham, Scholes, Neville's, Nicky Butts, and kind of grew up doing my apprenticeship with them. And obviously going to the games as a young apprentice and watching Manchester United, I was always at Old Trafford. Although my family, my father, my brother, we were always Man City fans, really. That was the team I went to watch as a young boy until, obviously, I signed to Man United.
So you might be not that happy that this year Liverpool are leading the table.
Well, we don't know what's going to go on with that. You know, every day there's a new story about the Premier League are going to get up and running soon, but if I was being biased, I'd just say get the league cancelled and don't let Liverpool win it.
That's very sad. Okay, so now we'll move on more to your career. And you, after your stint at Bengaluru FC, you signed for Penang FC, which did not exactly pan out like how you would want it to pan out. Yeah. So what? How would you describe your time at Malaysia?
Disappointing, if I was being honest. Obviously, coached in Asia, in India, and presumed that the mentalities would be similar. Indian boys and Malaysian boys, you get Indian Malays. I thought that, you know, it would be, you could go there with all your systems and players would respond. But it's pretty tough in Malaysia. You know, the attitude of the players is not great. You know, they don't work as hard as the Indian boys. They're not as responsive to structure and routine. And it was hard. There was a lot of political stuff happening in the background, you know, fighting for power. The Malaysian clubs are owned by the FAs. And you can have big committees with all different agendas from different people trying to get involved or get near the team. So it didn't work out from all kinds of aspects, really. And that was the reason why I resigned and got out of there. And also, it was different to Bangalore. I'd inherited a team of players that were already in place with low standards, to be honest. And the simple fact was that the players weren't good enough as what the other teams in the league were. So it was tough on many, many agendas and aspects.
So you have worked in various capacities in football. You have worked as a head coach, as an assistant manager, as you said, at Blackburn, as a player coach in the beginning of your career at Kettering Town.
Yeah.
And also as a technical director, which was your last job at ATK before you became the caretaker manager. Which position, according to you, do you like the most?
I prefer head coach, if I'm being honest. Where you can make the decisions. No, assistant is good as well, as long as you're assistant to somebody that's obviously good and you're going to learn off, which I was fortunate that I was in Michael Appleton. He was, you know, he'd done 11, 12 years at West Bromwich Albion in all different roles. He'd started as youth team, he'd gone up to the 23s, he'd been the reserve manager, he'd been the assistant to Roy Hodgson as well, and he'd also had a caretaker spell in the Premier League with West Brom, so he was a great mentor and someone to learn off. And then you meet different people. But if I was given a choice, I prefer head coach because, you know, you get that reward when you set up a team and you structure a team to the way you want them to play and they go and win a match. It's quite rewarding.
Okay. And also one of the things that fascinated me about you was you have both the UEFA Pro and the AFC Pro license. So why did you do the AFC? I think I presume that you did the UEFA Pro in the beginning and then the AFC Pro.
I actually did them almost alongside each other. But the AFC Pro was only a 12-month course, where the UEFA English Pro is 2 years with 8 modules in the UEFA one. But it was my AFC was going to finish earlier than my UEFA one. It finished a year earlier, so I wanted to get that. Just so I had it in case some rules changed or you had to be a pro license holder to continue in your role. And also just, you know, you can never stop learning. We had a 3-week module in Korea and on the AFC Pro, and you just get to see different cultures, different styles. We were coaching Korean boys that couldn't speak any English using a translator. So it was just to diversify really and just try and put another string to the bow and tick as many boxes as possible. I don't think there's too many that has both. I think there's only about 300 or so as the English UEFA Pro, which is a good honour to have. You know, it's very expensive and it's hard to get on the English one. You have to be invited by the English FA. And like I say, to be one of only 300 and odd in the world was good. But then to have the AFC Pro as well, you know, I don't think there's too many people that's got both. So it was just nice to have.
So it's been almost like around 2 years since your last job in football, at least in India. So what are your aims or goals in general for the future? Do you plan to come back to India? Do you have you got any job offers like in this time period?
Yeah, I mean, always open to offers and open to listen. I've got, you know, no plans not to come back, put it that way. You know, I've had a few bits. Obviously, things have stopped all of a sudden now because of the, you know, the pandemic that's going on and football's secondary at the minute. I think the world's are trying to, and rightly so, sort themselves out first. So I think a lot of football stuff has been put on hold. And then we'll see what the next challenge is. Obviously, I'm over in Australia at the minute. You know, I have a lot of contacts in England that I still speak to. You know, there's jobs always popping up in England. And like I say, yeah, you'd never say never, always willing to stay in the game, really, and see what's next.
Okay, this is just one random question, and this is just what I want to ask. according to you, which one do you prefer, man marking or zonal? When you put out your team, what do you prefer?
Man marking. There's no grey areas then. You know, if your man scores, it's your fault. You're not looking around at everybody else. I think zonal, you have to have the right personnel. You have to have, you know, five or six good headers of the ball that have the desire to go and head the ball. Because I think when you're zonal, you're always allowing the opposition to get a run on you. And when someone gets a run on you, they can outjump you. So I don't like it. I like body contact. I like people, you know, getting in and amongst it, you know, restricting players' movement with their own body. And I just think you can defend better as a man marker. I mean, I did it myself for years as a central defender. I actually took a lot of pride in it. And towards the end of my career, because I'd learned so much about it, that, you know, nobody would ever score against you because you knew how to do it properly. So if you coach it correctly, man marking's better. But, you know, you have to have the right coaches and you have to have the right people that do the jobs properly. But it's always a talking point. But personally, I prefer man marking.
So if you had to describe yourself as a coach, like, suppose you had to describe a team that is coached by you, what would be the most perfect or ideal team that you would want to put out? Like, how would they play?
I play, to be honest, I've always done it very similar to how Liverpool play. You know, one, defensive midfielder sitting at the bottom. Two, attacking midfielders that get forward in a 4-3-3. You know, a narrow front three, if you like, getting inside fullbacks on crosses from the opposite side, getting the goals. And then your fullbacks being really dynamic, high and wide and up the pitch and overlapping. And obviously your central defenders splitting at the back and your number four midfielder trying to come and get it off him and playing through the thirds. Always try and have my team super fit. Always try and play with lots of intensity and desire. And just try and basically smother team with physicality, pace, power and dynamic desire, really. That was my philosophy at Bangalore. That's the way I played and that's what worked for me. In saying that, you can't play every game the same. I know Liverpool can because they're so much better than other people. But sometimes, you know, in and amongst that, you look at the opposition as well and sometimes change your system as long as you coach it properly and you prepare properly and just look for weaknesses to exploit in your opposition as well.
So do you have any coach or coaches whom you look up to as inspiration as a coach?
Well, I like the way, obviously, Man City play. You know, the way they push their two midfielders of the three. One sits, obviously, but the two more or less go into the side as almost number 10s. And the wide players of the front three stay really wide. And they almost play five across the front when they attack. And that's quite nice to watch. You know, you've got, obviously, Klopp with his style and intensity at Liverpool. You've got Belisa at Leeds that is doing some good things in the Championship. Nagelsmann that's doing very well, obviously, in the Champions League and stuff. So there's all things. I mean, what's good these days is there's so much online you can access. There's so many articles you can read. And there's so many coaches, great coaches to look at. So you try and take a piece off everybody, really. There's no secret, really. There's no definite way of playing, but you just try and take snippets off everyone and then obviously incorporate your own style and philosophy as well.
So do you have any words to say for maybe any player or coach just starting out as a new freshbie?
Yeah, I mean, playing-wise, it's just practice as much as you can. You know, the 10,000-hour rule. You know, you don't become a master of your trade until you put those kind of hours in. So it can be anything. You know, sort your touch out, you can just kick the ball against the wall. 2 hours a day is as simple as that. So just practice and dedication as a player. And as a coach, just learn. You know, do your badges, do your hours, coach at every level possible. You know, whether that's under sixes, under sevens, you'll learn something from every occasion. You know, just go online and access information. It's all there. You know, you can get help from people. You can go and watch training. You can study people. You can, you know, contact people and ask for information and just get out there and coach, really. It's the same as playing, just practice.
This is your second last question from me. So, during your time in India, was there any particular ground which was very intimidating for you? Like, you would never go there and win or something, or it would be very difficult?
I'm just trying to think. I mean, there were some great grounds, to be honest, that, you know, little ones that stick in your mind, like Aizwal FC. we actually had a tough time at Shillong. The Shillong Le Jong was always tough to get a result. We managed to do it towards the end, but the pitch was really hard. It was a hard AstroTurf. Obviously, the climate can be different up there. The travel's tough. That was always a tough ground to go to. And then obviously Salt Lake Stadium. You know, we had mixed results there. We had some good wins, some good losses. And I think I ended up putting a window through once after getting sent off at Salt Lake Stadium. So that was always an interesting ground to go to.
So on that note, we'll ask you a final question. And no interview is complete without this controversial question, okay? So whom do you prefer, Lionel Messi or Cristiano Ronaldo?
I always judge it off who I would have the most difficult time playing against. Because I kind of looked at football like that because I was a central defender. And I think, although Messi, you know, might put the ball through your legs six times or whatnot, I think you could try and impose yourself physically on Messi. I think with Ronaldo, it's a different kettle of fish. You know, he's kind of got everything, or he did. I know he's getting older now, 33, and he's slowing down a little bit, and he's now more of an out-and-out centre-forward who feeds on crosses. But, you know, Ronaldo in his prime, with his physicality, his speed, you know, his athleticism, the way he can hurt you in the air as well, I would probably just tip Ronaldo. Although, like I say, ability-wise, you'd probably say Messi's the best. But I think just from a sheer who I wouldn't like to play against, I would say Ronaldo.
Okay, maybe that final 1% of the tip, maybe because you're from, you played in Manchester United.
Yeah, it's his physicality would be something that, you know, I would try and impose myself on Messi. I think you'd struggle to do that with Ronaldo.
Okay, on that note, thank you so much, Mr. Ashley Westwood, for talking to us. And we wish you all the best for your future campaigns. Hope you come back and maybe win all the possible trophies at your next club. And hope we can talk again soon. So on that note, thank you so much.
Perfect. Thank you very much. See you soon. Thanks. See you.